As you can see, Tim's not here. He is touring the northern part of the US up in Montana area, and he crossed over to Canada. He texted me on Friday morning, so hopefully he'll make it back. I know what they're like up there. They need more people. Okay, so some announcements. Pledges. If you pledged for the Neodon Village Library and you haven't given that in yet, please do so before November 1st. Just a quick word about pledges, just a reminder. Checks should be made to New Hope Community Church, but in the memo line you can put 1040i in this case because it's a non-profit organization. So the IRS doesn't like it if you put people's names in there, like if you put Mike Cousineau in there. They wouldn't like that, but 1040i is okay because they're actually a registered nonprofit. So that's just a quick reminder about how you write checks when it relates to pledges that you've made. Speaking of pledges, the Heinz Hospice event a while back, Tim pledged $2,500 on behalf of New Hope with the knowledge that New Hope would step up and fulfill that. So we're about halfway there. So if you would like to give to Heinz Hospice as part of that pledge, please, same thing, just write a check, put it in the offering with Heinz Hospice written on the memo line. Back to the Ivory Coast and 1040, the Neonan Junior High students that are on the board over there, we still need we're only about half sponsored right now for next year, so if you're interested in sponsoring a junior high student for next year, please, or as a small group, not just an individual, please put a mark on there that you want to do it, or just contact the office this week and let them know that you'd like to be a sponsor for next year for a junior high student. It's $585 for 12 months, and it supplies them with pretty much everything they need for education purposes and for living expenses, basically, for the year. So it's a great thing to do, and the pledges for that are due by November 1st as well. So next weekend, very important announcement. Next weekend is Make a Difference Sundays, and the times have changed. There's no 8 o'clock service next weekend. There's a 9 o'clock and a 10:45. And the Make a Difference Sunday basically means that you get to invite all the people that you've been afraid to invite before, because you have an excuse now, because we're telling you, invite your friends and bring them. Those people that you've been praying for or talking to, and you're just looking for an event or something that they can come to, then next Sunday is it. There's a small card in your bulletin. You can give this to them, and it has times of services on there, 9 o'clock and 10:45 for next weekend. It's a good opportunity to connect. The Love Our Neighbors thing, you've been talking to your neighbors as part of that. Here's an opportunity to give them something that will tell them, okay, we're having a special event for people other than just our normal members and attendees. So give them that and see if they turn up. Sometimes it's as simple as that. People often just want to be asked to come. So think about that. The next weekend also, on Saturday, October 1st, is the Backing the Badges barbecue. So this is prime rib, $10 per head, here at New Hope, organized by Teddy and a few other people. So if you have questions about that, go see Teddy. He'll be selling tickets for it in the pavilion. You could turn up, just pay $10. There's also drive-through if you don't want to stay or you don't have time to stay and eat. There's a drive-through, so you can get a prime rib sandwich on a drive-through, or you can buy tickets. Yes, Teddy. Oh, it's ribeye sandwich, sorry. Still beef, right? Ribeye. Thank you, Teddy, for that. So that'll be a great event. Come to that. All the proceeds go to the officers that were shot at the jail a while back. So well worth doing that. The tickets are good because you can sell them beforehand. You can buy them, give them to people, give them to employees, give them to co-workers to come to that, or you can sell them, and if they don't come, well, it's $10 that goes towards it anyway, and sometimes people just look for an excuse to donate and get a ticket in hand, so that'll be a great event. Widow's Lunch Bunch, Tuesday. It says in the bulletin that they'll be watching the movie Sully at 1:30. It's actually 2:20 now, so correction to that, it's 2:20 now on the movie Sully for the Widow's Lunch Bunch. There is a parents' meeting for kids that want to be in the Christmas play after the third service today at the Jam Center. It won't be a very long meeting. It's really just informational and just a way to figure out how many kids are going to be in the play. So if your kids are interested in doing the Christmas play, there's a short meeting in the Jam Center after the third service. Speaking of Jam, we need teachers, again, 5th and 6th, we need for the 9:15 service, and 3rd and 4th for the 10:45 service. So if you have this hankering to teach kids and you don't have to have any experience, the curriculum is pretty much spelled out. Just come and talk to Jennifer after the services or anytime. Just give her a call. Her email's on here. Contact her and say, I'm interested in teaching. We really need teachers. I've said it before and I'll say it again. That's the next generation of this church. So we have the opportunity to teach them and teach them well as Sunday school teachers. So do that if you are interested. Even if it's slight interest, contact Jennifer. We're also looking for substitutes. So that means that just when a teacher can't come, then you can have someone step in and teach just for that Sunday. That's a lot less of a commitment if the commitment is the issue. But just to let you know, Sunday school teachers don't teach every single Sunday. They teach every other month. So it's not every single Sunday through the year. It's just every other month. So if you're interested in that, contact Jennifer. City Fest. So the other card that we have, this is the Luis Palau Festival that's coming to Fresno in April. April 1st, 2nd. Tim talked about it a little bit last week. This is going to be huge. It's going to be a way to revive the city of Fresno and Clovis through various events, culminating in April 1st and 2nd. But the first event that's coming up that is open to the public and is a ticketed event, but it's free, is coming up on November 17th, and that's called Renew Gathering, and it's with Francis Chan and Luis Palau. They will be here at the Save Mart Center, and we have a short video just to illustrate that.
Fresno City Fest with Luis Palau is coming to the Valley. It all starts November 17th with a powerful night of prayer, renewal, and worship.
My name is Francis Chan, and I'm excited to join you for the Renew Conference.
This is Luis Palau, and I want to encourage you to join us at the Renew Gathering.
Our unity plays a huge role in this as we step out together in faith.
Join us for Renew with Luis Palau, Francis Chan, and a free concert with Jesus Culture music artists Derek Johnson and Ruthie Ridley.
I hope that you'll join me and Luis Palau for a night of encouragement, a night of digging into his word, a time of worship as we share our common heart for the city.
November 17th at Save Mart Center. Register for free at goodnewsinthevalley.org. That's goodnewsinthevalley.org.
Like I said, it's free, but it will fill up because a lot of churches are participating in this City Fest, so it's worth going on and registering for that. Also, last week, we gave out these cards, and this is related to City Fest, the Luis Palau City Fest. And on the back, it has five spaces for names of five people that you want us to pray for. People that are in your lives that you want to inject Jesus into their life. And it's an opportunity for us to prepare for you, to help you prepare, to ask them to City Fest in April. So you can write the names on there, just put it in the offering basket, and we will pray over these people. We did so in the staff meeting last week for all of you that filled out the cards. So just know that we will name every single one by name in prayer. Okay, I'd like to ask our ushers to come forward for our morning tithes and offerings. Okay, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we just give thanks for life. We are thankful for every day that you give us and the beautiful mornings that we have right now, the cool mornings and the warm days. We just love this change of season. Lord, we just pray for this city, the city of Clovis, city of Fresno, as we approach City Fest and all the events that are leading up to it. We pray for the organizers of these events. It really is outstanding to see the city leaders engaged in this project as well, just to make sure that there's true revival that will come to these cities over the next few months. We just pray for courage for those of us that are wanting to reach out to people, not just for the City Fest, but also for the Make a Difference next weekend. We just pray that we take that step and we invite people to come here and listen to what we have to say. We appreciate the people that make a difference immediately, those that are organizing this barbecue. We just pray for that event and money raised for that. We just pray for the officers and their continued recovery. We give thanks for all the families that are represented here at this church, and we pray this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
This morning, I'm excited to be here. We are going to be spending time in Psalm 121, hence the song choices. You've got the message already, so you can sit back and relax. The Psalm 121 to me is that I know you told me.
We're cranking it loud and it's like.
Don't turn it down.
There we go.
I'm loud enough. I was so excited. It was probably better if it wasn't on. So Psalm 121, I'm sorry, my bad. Down people. So anyways, I disappointed the sound people. I'm sorry. I love you both. I love you. Okay. We're okay. Psalm 121 is about that forever perspective, that being able to look beyond what is right in front of you. Tim told me that I could do Psalm 121 or 122. I read them both and immediately wanted to do Psalm 122 because Psalm 122 says things like, "Let us go to the house of the Lord, and for the sake of my brothers and my friends." And that is great small groups and community stuff right there. So that is right up my alley, and we've just relaunched small groups, and we're starting a church-wide study. So I decided I'm doing Psalm 122. And Psalm 121 says things like, "The Lord will protect you from all harm." And with what's in the news and what people are going through in the congregation, I decided I just didn't want to go there. So I would do Psalm 122, and then I decided the responsible thing to do was to pray about it, and I did, and the songs and the words of Psalm 121 and Psalm 23, which relates to Psalm 121, and then Tim sent me notes on both Psalms, and everything that had been flooding my heart and my mind was all Psalm 121. So if you're disappointed today, we'll blame it on the Holy Spirit. So then I decided I would do both. This took a lot of arguing to prepare for this. So then I decided I'm going to do both Psalms because then I could pick the like fun verses out of both and we could just have a great time with both Psalms. And then I could say that I was able to talk about two Psalms in one Sunday and it takes Tim three Sundays to do one Psalm. So I'm going to squeeze a little Psalm 122 just to fit that in, but decided that Psalm 121 was it. I kind of apologize without being too sorry if today's message is a little repetitive. I sometimes feel like a one-trick pony because today's message is about our hope in the Lord, and I know that most of the time I talk about hope in the Lord. But I'm a two-trick pony. I talk about hope in the Lord and community, which is kind of like the two greatest commandments. So if I'm going to be repetitive of those two things, I'm not going to feel that bad. Besides, I don't get to speak very often, so you probably forgot what I talked about last time, so it's okay. The message is repetitive here, too, right? The message that God loves us and wants us to choose him, and he wants to bless us, and he wants to be with us, and to restore us to him, and to spend eternity with us. Amen? Not a bad repetitive message. So let's read, I'm not even in Psalm 121, I don't know where I am. Let's read Psalm 121. I lift up my eyes to the hills. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. He will not let your foot slip. He will watch over you. He who watches over you will not slumber. Indeed, he who watches over Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord watches over you. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun will not harm you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all harm. He will watch over your life. The Lord will watch over your coming and going, both now and forevermore. Amen. When I first read verse 7, the Lord will keep you from all harm. He will watch over your life. I had just read the articles that retold and provided more information into the death of Kayla Mueller, the humanitarian. Oh, see, I thought I got it out. 8 o'clock service, sorry. I got a free hanky out of my mess last service, so Glenn Mattson saved me. Thank you. Kayla Mueller, you might remember on the news, she was the humanitarian aid worker from Prescott, Arizona. Sorry, tried to get it out at 8 o'clock. Who was taken captive in 2013 in Syria and then killed in 2015. There have been appalling tragedies all over the world and then really sad things going on in the lives of people right here. And I thought, I don't want to read that verse to a congregation that has many hurting people. And it's not that I don't believe it. It's just one of those things that you hear and it creates a little bit of tension. It's like Jeremiah 29:11, which I love that verse. It is written on my heart. It's a go-to verse. It's engraved on the inside of my husband's wedding ring. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future. And I believe those verses, and I've worked through those verses, and I have processed them and read them in context so that I understand that it doesn't promise that my path is clear. These verses are a promise of redemption to a people in captivity, and God is saying, I want to bring you back. The best part of Jeremiah 29:11 is the verses after it. Jeremiah 29, verse 12. Good thing I have my cheater Bible here with my tabs. Jeremiah 29, for I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future. Then you will call upon me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you. You will seek me and find me. When you seek me with all your heart, I will be found by you, declares the Lord, and I will bring you back from captivity. I will gather you from all the nations and places where I have banished you, declares the Lord, and will bring you back to the place from which I carried you into exile. He wants to listen to us. He wants us to find him. He wants to restore us and gather us up. So, like I said, God's been working on me to help me understand Psalm 121. As I was contemplating the psalm, I kept thinking about Psalm 23, right? Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil, for thou art with me. And we know, because Pastor Tim took a lot of weeks to work through that psalm, that this psalm is about walking through those terrible times, facing death, and knowing that we are not alone, and having that eternal perspective. And I think back to Kayla Mueller. And I remember standing in me and Ed's, my nephew's birthday party, crying with my mom. And they were announcing on the news her death and sharing her story and telling about her death. And I said to my mom, this is really sad. But based on the descriptions and what they're saying about her, I don't think that this 23-year-old woman would have chosen anything different. I don't believe that she would have chosen a quiet and safe life because her heart was bent on service, and she is now in the glory of her Jesus. The recent information has shared a lot more that has given us that perspective. Kayla was tortured, isolated, assaulted, and killed. Harm came to her physical body. There was a woman called Julia who spent time with Kayla in captivity and said in a 2020 interview that Mueller passed up a chance at an escape in order to increase the odds for the Yazidi teens who were able to sneak out of an ISIS kingpin's house late one night in a flight to freedom. The woman asked Kayla to come with them, and she said, no, because I am an American, if I escape with you, they will do everything to find us again. The news story went on to say that under a full moon, the Yazidi girls finally made their escape, parting tearfully with their older protective sister. They eventually made their way back to Erbil in Kurdistan in northern Iraq, where Julia helped U.S. military intelligence officers find the Sayeth houses. A Delta Force raid in May of last year resulted in Abu Sayyaf being shot to death and his wife being taken prisoner by the American operators. Mueller was praying for us to escape, to survive, said Julia. I will never forget the sacrifice. She was good to us. I will never forget. Kayla was able to smuggle some letters out to her parents before her death, and this is what she wrote. I remember Mom always telling me that all in all, in the end, the only one you really have is God. I have come to a place and experience where, in every sense of the word, I have surrendered myself to our Creator, because literally there was no one else. And by God and by your prayers, I have felt tenderly cradled in free fall. I have been shown in darkness light, and I have learned that even in prison, one can be free. I am grateful. I have come to see that there is good in every situation. Sometimes we just have to look for it. I pray each day that if nothing else, you have felt a certain closeness and surrender to God as well. And have formed a bond of love and support amongst one another. That is God. In the midst of the terrible things, the isolation, the torture, and the assault, she knew that her God was with her and protecting her soul. I desperately want to pretend that these things are not happening, but they are. And not because of God, but because of the evil one. And God has and will protect us from the evil one. Jesus has paid the price for our sin. He took our punishment so that we could be forgiven and spend eternity with him. Eternity without evil. Not this place where for a short time we share space with the evil one. And while here, God promises to be light in darkness and to never leave us nor forsake us. And I do believe that when we are in fellowship with him and walking in the valley, we will recognize his shade and the wing of shelter over us, and ultimately, he will guard our soul. Verse 7 of Psalm 121 in the New American Standard says it this way: the Lord will protect you from all evil. He will keep your soul. Amen. This version helped me see that this was not about earthly physical protection, but a promise of eternity. The word evil or harm in the NIV is translated from the Hebrew word ra. And this is the same Hebrew word used in Psalm 23. I fear no evil, for thou art with me. And in Jeremiah 29:11, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, or bring calamity in the New American Standard Version. I love the song better, We Will Dance, because it demonstrates the joy I have when I think about heaven and how I increasingly understand Paul in Philippians 1:21. For me, to live is Christ and to die is gain. I think it's interesting that this verse doesn't tell us to live is Christ and die is gain, but says for me. And I think that has to do with perspective and spiritual maturity to say for me. If I woke up today, then my day, my life is Christ in me to do his will and to die is gain, because I'll be in heaven and have finished this race. And that's easier said than truly lived or believed. I think that is why I'm so emotional about like the song In Christ Alone, because I believe the words. It's Easter Sunday stuff, and I love Easter. Easter's coming. Okay, I know that Christmas is coming, but, and this is nice. I like fall, but I don't have the same level of enthusiasm about Christmas, and I know I should. It's important that Jesus was born, but I love Easter. Like, I get so excited about Resurrection Sunday. Some people say, like, it was like Christmas morning. I'm like, this is like Resurrection Sunday stuff. Like, I love Easter. I can't. So, if I am alive, then I want the words of In Christ Alone to reflect me and my beliefs. No guilt in life, no fear in death. This is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand. Amen. Till he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ, I'll stand. And I ask myself, am I standing firm in his truths or being swayed by the trials and tribulations of this world? Do people see his truths in my life? Am I telling people about the joy and peace I have in the midst of chaos? Does my countenance radiate even though evil is present? Do I and do others know where my help comes from? If I asked people, would they say, Corey seeks the Lord and rests in the shade of his wing in peace and in war. Psalm 121 and 122 are pilgrimage psalms. This means that they were sung among the people as they traveled to Jerusalem to attend annual festivals to worship the Lord in the temple. Journeys that were long and difficult, ones that I have no interest in traveling. We drive to Arizona often, and it's a long drive. And although I do like a desert landscape, it can be boring after a while. And then it starts to sound something like this in the car. This is so boring. How much longer? Oh, look, another cactus. This sand is destroying my paint job. It would be bad if the air conditioner went out right now. Did we remember to get gas in Indio? No, we did not remember to get gas in Indio. I'm almost out of soda pop and M&Ms. Whatever will I do? How many more movies do we have to watch before we get there? The struggle is real. They have portable DVD players, right? I have to go to the bathroom. Where is the bathroom? Wait, there's no bathroom? And on, right? Like, this is bad. But imagine walking that stretch with your children and your belongings, and then there's enemies lurking, and people want to hurt you and steal your stuff, and then there's animals on top of that. I mean, I'm okay with like a lizard, but beyond lizards, I have no interest in anything lurking or pouncing or whatever's out there. No, thank you. So in context, this is what the people are singing as they travel. I'm not in Psalm 121. Sorry, I am in Jeremiah still. They are singing. Bethany, you want to start singing? You know Psalm 121. I lift up my eyes to the hills. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. There's a couple of ways to read this, right? I'm traveling and I'm looking at these mountains, these arduous, difficult journey. Where does my help come from? You know what? I'm going to keep walking because my help comes from the Lord, the maker of those mountains. He's bigger than those mountains. That's one way of looking at it. The message says, I look up to the mountains. Does my strength come from the mountains? No. My strength comes from God. And I do think sometimes we look to creation for rest. We look to creation for hope and solitude and those kinds of things. And we've got to look to the maker of those mountains, the creator of that. He knows everything. He loves us and he wants good things for us. So why is he often our last resort for wisdom and comfort? Verses 3 and 4, he will not let your foot slip. He watches over you. He who watches over you will not slumber. Indeed, he who watches over Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. We have to turn our eyes to a higher perspective and not let the trials of the world blind us to the good. We need that upper story perspective. The evil one wants to trip us up, make us stumble, be discouraged, and then blame God for it and turn from him. Especially with social media and internet, we are surrounded by bad news. We don't have to wait for the 5 o'clock news to hear it or the morning paper. It's everywhere. But there is good happening. We just don't, it's not the first thing reported. It would be nice if every once in a while, after my place of employment is on the news, that it was like, where was yesterday's news report that may have gone something like this? Today at the local high school, students went to class and learned a lot while also positively interacting with adults and other students on campus. Furthermore, people were attentive and responsive, taking care to prevent many incidents. Also, the local hospital made good choices and followed protocols, and many people are healing as a result. In other news, your police officers, first responders, and neighbors did their jobs appropriately and treated each other with courtesy and respect. That's all for tonight. Thank you, and be good to one another. Right? Those things are happening. We're just not talking about them. Maybe we need to be talking about them and be celebrating the good so that people hear the good amongst the negative. When bad things happen, we might think that God is asleep or forgotten us. These verses remind us that God doesn't sleep. He's not like the pagan gods that were believed to be sleeping and then had to be awakened in order to do something. Our God doesn't nap. He is always watching over us and is always with us. Bad things happen because there's evil in the world, but God shows himself in many ways if we are willing to see. But sometimes we need to slow down, pray, and ask for a heavenly perspective. We also learn from this psalm to keep walking. If you are in fellowship with him, though the path may be a little scary or difficult, he will not let you slip, and you are not alone. Your travel companion is not sleeping in the passenger seat, drooling while you are driving, as I do, which is why we're flying to Arizona this next time. As the great modern psalmist Toby Mack says, I know your heart been broke again. I know your prayers ain't been answered yet. I know you're feeling like you got nothing left. Well, lift your head. It ain't over yet. It ain't over yet. Verses 5 to 8 says, the Lord watches over you. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun will not harm you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all harm. He will watch over your life. The Lord will watch over your coming and going, both now and forevermore. Remember that nothing can separate you from God. If you believe that Jesus Christ is Lord and Savior, you've acknowledged that you're a sinner, asked for God's forgiveness, and committed your life to God, then God has given you his power through the Holy Spirit. And that cannot be taken away. Evil, sickness, and death might destroy your physical body, but God has your soul, and he will guard your going out and your coming in from this time forth and forevermore. Amen. So what does this have to do with spiritual simplicity? As you know, our small groups have reconvened, some of that have been taking breaks. New people have joined. It's not too late if you're interested. Our church-wide study is spiritual simplicity. And if you've seen the trailer or you've started to watch the videos, Chip Ingram is drinking coffee with his beautiful dog and he's in a cabin. And it's to create a feeling of solitude and reflection. As much as I like a warm cup of coffee on a cool morning, the heart of the message is to eliminate the noise, the distraction, and the busyness, to quiet your soul so that you can hear and know God's leading to move, to go on a pilgrimage and a journey with him, to fellowship with him and to show God's love to others. Spiritual simplicity talks about how in our distractions and busyness, we say someday. Someday I will spend more time with this person. Someday I'll go on that mission trip. Someday I'll serve here or decide to visit this neighbor. But Chip says, someday doesn't come unless we stop and decide to simplify our lives because we live in a world that moves too fast, delivers too little, and demands too much. As we go through this church-wide study in small groups, I want to be clear that the goal is not to have super relaxed people with coffee in hand and a bunch of margin in their lives. But my prayer is that we'd be able to either identify and deal with what is keeping us from walking in intimate fellowship with our Savior and loving Him with our whole heart and therefore loving others as He planned for us, or to find fellowship and support and strength as we continue to keep walking on a path that is not always easy. This has to do with realizing that loving God and loving others is most important. And ultimately, if we are in Christ, we are safe because we have eternity with Him. It's like Esther. In Esther 4, when Mordecai, the family member who raised her, encourages her to go to the king to seek mercy for the Jews. And she says in Esther 4, sorry, I gotta find Esther. I could do bookmarks. In Esther 4, verse 11, all the king's officials, she says back, all the king's officials and the people of the royal provinces know that for any man or woman who approaches the king in the inner court without being summoned, the king has but one law, that he be put to death. The only exception to this is for the king to extend the gold scepter to him and spare his life. But 30 days have passed since I was called to go to the king. When Esther's words were reported to Mordecai, he sent back this answer. Do not think that because you are in the king's house, you alone of all the Jews will escape. For if you remain silent at this time, relief and deliverance for the Jews will arise from another place. But you and your father's family will perish. And who knows but that you have come to this royal position for such a time as this. Then Esther sent this reply to Mordecai. Go, gather together all the Jews who are in Susa and fast for me. Do not eat or drink for 3 days, night or day. I and my maids will fast as you do. When this is done, I will go to the king, even though it is against the law. And if I perish, I perish. Esther and Mordecai looked higher. They had an upper story perspective. Esther didn't step out in faith to do the right thing because she didn't think harm would come to her. She said, if I perish, I perish, because her soul was safe from all evil, and that is what mattered. In Romans 8, this is reiterated in Romans 8, starting in verse 31. This is good stuff. Romans 8, verse 31. What then shall we say in response to this? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Who is he that condemns? Christ Jesus, who died and more than that was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. We are more than conquerors. We are the children of the Almighty God, and he loves us. The evil one seeks to confuse and destroy, and he deceives. But don't you notice that even the best deceiver can only last so long? I read an article about the actor Jason Lee, I love him, has shared that he no longer practices Scientology. And in this article, they brought up other celebrities like Leia Remini, who have left the church. And the church's response in talking about Leia Remini and her vocal, she's sharing her experience. Their response is this. Leia Remini knows the truth she conveniently rewrites in her revisionist history. The real story is that she desperately tried to remain a Scientologist in 2013, knowing full well she was on the verge of being expelled for refusing to abide by the high level of ethics and decency Scientologists are expected to maintain. Expelled. They were going to expel her. So they're saying, She can say what she wants, but we were going to get rid of her first. And so now, because we were going to get rid of her, she's saying she's getting rid of us. That is not, that is, that, those are schemes of man to think that way, right? It does not make them look better. Our God loved us before we loved him, right? He died for us while we were still yet sinners and promises to never leave us nor forsake us. The evil one draws us in with empty promises and fake and phony perfection and then shames us when we leave. That is not God. My prayers are with her and Jason Lee and the others as they go on this difficult journey. Because if you have ever left darkness or a false church to rebuild, you know how difficult that is. But we remember Jeremiah 29, that he wants us to find him. He wants to gather us up together, and he wants to redeem and restore us. Where are you looking for help? What kind of help are you expecting? Are you looking only for earthly treasure and comfort? Are you looking high enough? Are you seeing the heavenly, eternal perspective? We are on a difficult journey, so let's travel together. We are surrounded by lies and evil, but God has given us the power of Holy Spirit to guide us and comfort us. He's given us his word to teach us and encourage us, and he's given us each other. Psalm 122:1, let us go to the house of the Lord. Let's pray. Dear Lord, thank you for loving us first. Thank you for paying the price for our sin and forgiving us. Thank you for the hope of eternity with you that we can rest in and find joy in. Please help us look to you and find you as we journey through life and help us love others. I pray for the lost and the brokenhearted and those that are afraid. We pray for courage to keep walking and step out in faith where you lead us. All glory and honor is yours. Amen. When we start to fear those difficult mountains ahead, remind each other to look higher than the mountains and keep walking.